Okay, guys, this is my next step in my video series on toxins and detoxification. This video will be on heavy metals and chelation. I apologize, my voice isn't top-notch today, but we're gonna knock this video out anyway. There's a lot I wanna talk about, and so I tried to put as much of it on the board as I could to remind myself. This is certainly not an all-inclusive heavy metal dissertation, but hopefully it's gonna give you the basics of heavy metals and chelation, which is the process of removing them or the treatment of heavy metals. And we're just going to go ahead and get started. If you don't know me already, my name is Dr. Philip Oob. I'm a functional medicine doctor here in Austin, Texas. And as you can tell, I pace around in front of a whiteboard. So let's get started. Let's start talking about heavy metals. And no, we're not talking about rock bands or Aussie or anything like that. We're talking about the heavy metals that you are exposed to on a daily basis, whether you realize it and want to accept it or not. I test almost every patient that comes through my door at some point in their health wellness journey. We're testing for heavy metals because it's one of those hidden sources of toxins that you don't know if you have unless you've been tested or not. I myself took supplements for multiple years, 3 or 4 years, in fact, before I finally did my heavy metal testing. And I was high in mercury even after taking years of supplements and working on my detox pathways, eating organic foods and all that. So if you are out there struggling with any kind of autoimmunity, inflammation, joint pains, brain fog, fatigue, really any complaint whatsoever, you should consider looking into heavy metals. But in this area of toxins and detoxification, this is one of the only areas in functional medicine that we deal with that is somewhat dangerous. And I don't want to say that to spook you, because I believe the way I do it and the protocols I've developed are designed to be safe and slow and effective removal of heavy metals without putting you at risk. But removing metals, you cannot forget that when you're removing metals, you are also removing beneficial elements like calcium, magnesium, zinc, selenium, molybdenum, all those beneficial elements. So when you're choosing a provider to get heavy metals out, make sure you're choosing someone who is not too aggressive, who knows what they're doing and has treated patients before. So let's run the list. I certainly didn't put every heavy metal on the board, but certainly the ones that are really important to me. So let's run the list. Aluminum, antimony, arsenic, cadmium, gadolinium, lead, mercury, nickel, thallium, and tin. I have at least seen one patient with each one of these and multiple of lead, mercury, and tins and gadoliniums. So these are very real metals that are in our environment and you've been exposed to. And it's only a matter of how much has your body accumulated. So you may not be exposed to more gadolinium is a perfect example for you may not be exposed to more gadolinium than the next person, but for some reason, your body likes to accumulate gadolinium for some reason. So I've got one patient that has had multiple MRIs looking at a brain tumor in her head, and every time she gets an MRI, she gets gadolinium. Yet her levels, although they were high, her levels were less than another patient who hadn't had an MRI for 5 years, and her levels were even higher. So it's not about how much you've been exposed to, although that, of course, does matter. It really matters about your accumulation. A good place to look is Flint, Michigan. If you look at the people of Flint, Michigan, they were all exposed to lead, but not everyone developed overaccumulation, and hardly anyone developed the same symptoms. Of course, they were generalities of things that happened, but heavy metals affects everyone differently, and it depends on which one you've exposed to and which one you've accumulated is what could possibly be causing that problem. So how do heavy metals affect you? That's the most common question that people don't fully understand, but it's actually fairly simple. If you go online and Google health benefits of magnesium and calcium and zinc and selenium, any one of those, any supplements that you might already be taking in a multivitamin or selenium, molybdenum, any of those individual supplements, those are many of those that I just listed are minerals or metals. And your body is designed to accumulate minerals and metals. It's supposed to. Your bones are made out of it. Your energy processes use iron to carry oxygen. Your blood uses iron to carry the oxygen. And then iron is used inside of every one of your cells and the mitochondria to actually make energy. Magnesium is used as a cofactor. It's everywhere. So anywhere you see the benefit of a beneficial metal, you can pretty much insert bad metal and then take away that benefit and cause the opposite. Oh, magnesium is good for blood pressure. Well, cadmium is bad for blood pressure. Magnesium is good for sleep. Well, mercury is bad for sleep. It lists anything and you can pretty much find what that metal can do that's terrible. So I'm not going to spend a whole lot of time on the symptoms of what metals can do, other than you understanding the basics that they can cause anything from brain fog and fatigue to cancer to autoimmunity and everything in between. Heavy metals can do them all. So why is this a problem now? It's a problem now is because we're with our modern industrial society, we've been digging the earth and mining things like cadmium for our batteries and our paint, lead. I don't need to even beat that horse. That one's been ruled toxic for unfortunately, like 20 years, should have been longer. But many of these metals have been pulled out of the earth and used in various degrees. And certainly I've used plenty of aluminum foil and aluminum cans and many of these things that you see up here. But it's a matter of how much you've been exposed to and how much your body has accumulated over time. One thing I do want to point out specifically about the heavy metals that I neglected to mention a second ago as far as what they can cause. I mentioned autoimmunity and the theory behind why heavy metals cause autoimmunity is if you take the same protein, let's use hemoglobin for example, since everyone understands what hemoglobin is. Hemoglobin is the red blood cell that's inside your blood vessels that's carrying the iron. It's got that iron molecule. Well, if you pull that iron molecule out or iron atom and put a heavy metal in there, you've now changed this protein and what it looks like to the body. So if you imagine all over your body, you have these minerals and metals, magnesium, zinc, selenium, inside of proteins. And these proteins depend on those metals to function properly. But instead, you take a foreign metal, let's say arsenic, and put that metal in its place. Now, all of a sudden, that protein can't function correctly. It can't do its job, whatever it may be, whether it's to make energy or make memories or make happiness, whatever it may be, it's interfering with that process. But how does it go above and beyond and create autoimmunity is in that same feature. Anytime you add a metal into a protein structure, you actually change how it looks. So the 3D structure of a protein is built around the amino acid sequence. And as soon as the body designs this protein, it immediately takes a shape, kind of like a paper clip. I love to use the paperclip as an analogy of a protein. And so a paperclip is a thin piece of metal wrapped in a certain way that has a function. As long as that paperclip is wrapped in that way, it serves its function. But if at any point you put a kink in the paperclip or unbend it, that's not a word, if you bend it or change its shape, it's now just a piece of metal, but it can't actually do its duty. And now it actually doesn't even look like a paperclip. That is the same thing your body does. So if you take out this iron molecule and all of a sudden stick in a cadmium molecule and you change that protein structure at all, it can actually take a foreign appearance to your body because your body knows what the 3D shape of your own internal proteins look like, your human proteins. But if you change the 3D structure of that human protein, it can then be identified as foreign. And then the body says, hey, there's some sort of foreign protein in here, attack it. And now you have an autoimmune condition because you have too much cadmium stuck to your red blood cells or stuck to the outside of your pancreatic cells. And now you've developed type 1 diabetes. To be honest, we do not understand how all of these heavy metals interfere with our immune system in creating autoimmunity. And unfortunately, heavy metals are being swept under the rug. Chelation is not very popular. There's a lot of people fighting against it instead of trying to learn more about what's happening. If heavy metals aren't that big of a deal, then why did we make a big deal in Flint, Michigan? I rest my case. So, of course, lead in Flint, Michigan was a big deal. But all of these metals I found in people in higher levels than the federal government agrees to based on the NHANES level, NHANES. And you can look up those levels of they've been testing humans for decades of what humans in America are naturally urinating out. And if you're going to urinate out more than the average human, then you're probably toxic in those metals. You can look that up. That's a public data. So where are these metals stored? And really, they're stored everywhere. So I am a terrible artist, but I tried to draw some of the diagrams so you could see. These metals can be stored in your brain. They can be stored in your liver. They can be stored in your heart. Anything that's rapidly dividing, they can be stored in. They can be in your intestines, in your stomach, anywhere. You don't know where they're deposited. And quite frankly, even in our testing, we can't tell you where they're deposited. We can just tell you how much is inside you. Bone is one of the trickiest ones. So your bone is a crystalline structure with calcium ions all tied inside it. Well, you can replace calcium, which is a mineral, with lead or mercury or arsenic or cadmium, any of those. Cadmium actually really loves the bone. And if you replace that crystalline structure with some of these metals, you can actually get fragile bones and you can weaken those bones. If you've ever held lead or played with lead is very malleable. It is a really heavy metal, but it's very malleable. You can bend it, you can shape it, you can bite it and change the structure of it. So if you can imagine, if you're incorporating odd metals into bone instead of calcium, you actually get a more breakable bone. And they may actually be dense on x-ray, but they break really easily. And not to mention just the sheer presence of it in that crystalline structure changes the strength of the bone. But it also is interfering with the osteoclasts and osteoblasts, the cells inside of the bone that are both destroying bone and remaking bone at the same time, constantly turning over that bone to regenerate it. So if you've got too many metals inside those cells and they're not able to work properly, then they're going to stop building bone, or they're going to break down bone inappropriately. And if you have an imbalance of either of those, now you have osteoporosis. So I test all of my osteoporotic women, and I've got some young women with osteoporosis who we believe one of the contributing factors is heavy metals, in addition to hormones and all that. So I don't want to go in grave detail about the sources of heavy metals, because you can Google any one of those and find out the sources of them. The truth is that you have been exposed whether you like it or not. I ask all of my patients that come in, what heavy metal exposures have they had? And in general, it's like the same question with mold. In general, most people say, well, I haven't had any. Well, it's funny, because every time I test someone and the metals come out, all of a sudden they get real serious about their exposures to metals, and they start finding out, oh yeah, that's where I got that lead, or oh yeah, that's where I got that mercury. So just recently I got the highest lead level I've ever seen, and previous to that, the highest lead I ever saw was like 30, and this lady rocked 150. And so in further digging, she thought for longer about it. She grew up in New Orleans for 30, 40 years. She lived there. Maybe she lived in an old house with lead pipes. Maybe New Orleans has lead pipes. Maybe she was drinking lead-infested water and never even knew it. And now she realizes that maybe her chronic fatigue that she's been chasing for so many years, eating gluten and dairy-free and all this perfect nutrition, but not really feeling that bit much better, maybe it's because her lead is 150, and that's highly abnormal. But I digress. So I briefly touched on sources of them. The gadolinium is one that I specifically want to point out. If you've ever had an MRI with contrast, that is gadolinium. Now, you can get it from water supply and food and all that. That's our common sources of any of these metals. But gadolinium, you get an infusion of it as a metal, and it lights up the arteries, and that's why they use it in the MRI. You're supposed to urinate out most of it, but some people accumulate a lot of it, and we don't really understand why. But gadolinium is a big problem in those people that accumulated. So this is the difference between two people can get the same dose, but one person gets sick and the other doesn't. And if you never get tested, you have no idea how much of that gadolinium you kept inside you. The other one I want to point out that's especially dangerous is cadmium. Cadmium, even at lower levels, seems to be a really toxic metal. Each metal kind of has its own personalities. So cadmium is mainly found in batteries and paint. We removed lead from paint and added cadmium in instead. So many people have too much cadmium on board. If you're a cigarette smoker or ever were a cigarette smoker, your levels are always higher than a non-smoker. I don't think that transmits to vapes, but I'm not quite sure. So number two point, your accumulation matters more than your actual dose, although obviously the more you get exposed to, the more you're likely to accumulate. And number three, I want to get into testing.